This is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takas, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another episode of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takas, your podcast co-host. We have an awesome episode for you today that's titled, How to Improve Your 9 Most Important KPIs. Hey, before I get to that content in this episode, two quick announcements to make. The first announcement is coming up on June 21st, 22nd, and 23rd is our next Thriving Dentist MBA workshop. It's a 9-hour workshop that we spread over 3 hours an evening, where I go into depth about the 10 elements of a thriving practice, including the 24 systems in a thriving practice, the 6 goals I'd like each and every one of you to embrace, and how to truly develop a practice that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction. It's done in a live stream format, meaning that you attend virtually from the comfort of your home or office. It is done live. It's not recorded. It's done live. So that way I can engage with the attendees and you can get lots more benefit out of it by being able to ask questions and engage with me in that workshop. Come join us. Again, it's happening June 21st, 22nd, and 23rd, 7 to 10 p.m. Eastern time each evening. If you'd like to register for that, very inexpensive. You get 9 hours of CE, very inexpensive tuition, perhaps the most affordable postgraduate CE you can attend. You can register by going to thrivingdentist.com/MBA. Hey, I look forward to seeing you there. The next announcement is we have a wonderful clinical tip from Dr. Vilas Sastry. And this tip is a really practical one. I'll give you a little teaser on this one. This is something I think you will use today in your practice. How's that for practical? And what Dr. Sastry is going to share with you is a great way to answer the question from your patient, is this going to hurt? Well, you're going to love what Dr. Sastry has to say about this. And without further ado, here's that top clinical tip.
Hi, my name is Dr. Vilas Sastry. I am the founder of Aces Dental, a multi-specialty DSO in Las Vegas. We were recently acquired by a larger DSO, and I have since transitioned to teledentistry. I grew my practices from scratch to a multi-million dollar operation with some simple yet effective methods that I use to get patients to be more comfortable during treatment. So, here's my clinical tip for the listeners of this show. So when a patient asks you, doctor, is this going to hurt? Instead of recoiling and trying to fumble through an answer, you answer with confidence and you say, yes, it is going to hurt. And you follow up with that and say, but I'm going to give you an anesthetic that will take away most of the pain. So you'd be surprised, but when you kind of use this type of reverse psychology on a patient, they actually are now more willing to let you give them the anesthetic, and it relaxes their muscles, it sets their mind at ease, and with the promise that it will get them numb for the actual procedure. So that's my clinical tip. Try it out and see the results for yourself.
Welcome back to the Thriving Dentist Coaching and Action segment. I'm excited about our topic today, how to improve your 9 most important KPIs. Before we get started, I just wanted to make a quick announcement. We're going to make a tiny change to our format. Typically, as you all know, you're used to seeing the Coaching and Action segment followed by a Q&A segment. Today, these 9 KPIs are going to require around 40 minutes of our time to really explain and go through and talk about how to improve each one of them. So Gary and I decided to not have the Q&A segment. So you're going to have this extended 40 minutes plus conversation around what are these 9 KPIs and how you can improve them. Let me share something else with you. This episode is also different in one other way. It is almost like, think of it like a behind the scenes look at what happens in the Thriving Dentist Coaching Program. As you all know, Gary focuses on a few objectives. The first one being he wants his clients to make every year their very best year in terms of how much money they take home, how much money they collect. So to achieve that, one of the techniques is to work on these 9 KPIs and improve these 9 KPIs. Because when these 9 KPIs improves, Gary knows from his 42 years experience that they end up having their best year every year. Also in this process, one of the side benefits is that 24 systems get embedded one by one, because many of these KPIs are linked to Gary's 24 systems and are critical in helping us improve these 9 KPIs. Two other points I want to make is you all have heard of the 6 goals of a thriving practice. We'll put a link in our show notes. And one of those goals is overhead no higher than 60%. Again, these KPIs are critical in you achieving overhead no higher than 60%. Finally, one of the other goals is a team you love working with. And this high performance team is again critical for you to have a thriving practice. And again, these 9 KPIs are critical in you creating an environment where you attract the best people and keep the best people. So Gary, I'm looking forward to it. I know we are changing our format, but I think it's going to be worth it.
Yeah, you know, Naren, a thriving practice doesn't just happen by clicking our fingers. It happens through concerted action towards very specific objectives. And one thing I'll disclose to our listeners who may already know this, if you're a longtime listener, you likely already know this. If you're a new listener, you're about to discover something about me, is that I am OCD when it comes to goals. Literally OCD. I think if you look up, goals under Wikipedia, you'll see my picture. And if you look up OCD, I believe you'll find my picture there under Wikipedia. I'm not apologizing for it. I am OCD when it comes to goals. Personally, you know, in my life, professionally, you know, in my business life, in my athletic life, you know, I'm OCD when it comes to goals. And so you don't achieve a goal simply by wishing for it. Wishing is great, you know, a power of positive thinking, wishing is great, but you achieve that by taking concerted action towards that goal. So when we think about our practice, it's an ecosystem where something we do in one area affects things in other areas as well. It doesn't exist in a vacuum. And, you know, I think we've all had the experience in our practice where we put a system in place. And we think that that system is embedded, like in bedrock in your practice, like it's there. And then over time, that system just evaporates into ether. I think if it was a live audience, and I asked that question, how many of you have put a system in place in your practice and discover later that it's completely disappeared? I think everybody in the room would raise their hand, including me. That happened in our own practice when we put these, when we worked on putting these systems in place. I thought they were there. I thought they were embedded. But many of them evaporated. And I think the reason that happens, this could be many reasons, but one of the reasons that happens is the system isn't tied to a specific KPI that we can measure. When we have something we can measure, we can manage it. Peter Drucker famously said, Peter Drucker is considered by many to be the father of the science of business management. And Peter Drucker famously said, you can't manage what you don't measure.
Right.
And so if you have systems in place that are just kind of like paperwork procedural and they're not leading to something specific in the practice, those systems are going to evaporate because people start to see them as busy work. And they don't, and even the doctor starts to see it as less than critical. You know, it's a less than critical operation. So what I want to do in this thriving, coaching in action segment is I want to introduce the 9 KPIs, what I think are the most important KPIs to measure. And then we're going to go back and tie them to specific systems in the practice. And when you put the two, when you weave that together, the 9 KPIs with these systems, you end up having a recipe to drive your practice forward, to drive it in. And that's something that you can keep driving to new levels of, there's always a new level of performance. There's always another level to achieve. And that way we can have, you know, continuous improvement in the practice. Let me start by introducing those 9 KPIs. I'll number them. They're not numbered in importance, but they're numbered. I'm going to list them really quick, and then I'll talk about each one, and then we'll talk about the systems that relate to each KPI. Number one, Google reviews. Google reviews. Number two, the KPI is call conversions. What call conversions mean is what percent of the inbound calls that come into our practice from potential new patients get converted to a new patient appointment. Number three, very important, we want to measure our new patient flow. How many new patients do we get each month? Very, very important. You know, that's a way to take a pulse of your practice health by looking at your new patient flow. Number four, hygiene production. You all know that I am very much a hygiene-driven person. And in the ideal practice, our hygiene production should be one-third of our total office production. So we want to monitor and track hygiene production. Number five, total office production. Of course, we also want to talk the total office production. Number six, our whitening procedures. How many whitening procedures do we do each month? I'll come back and talk about that. Total office collections. Well, that may be the most important KPI because that represents your bottom line. Know what you're actually collecting. It's great to produce it, but you got to collect it. What are total office collections? Number eight, we look at the collection percentage, kind of a subcategory under office collections to know what our collection percentage is. And number nine, we want to look at the total accounts receivable ratio. All the money that's owed the practice, we want to look at that as a total AR ratio number. Now, let me go back and talk about each one. Number one, Google reviews. Google reviews are critically important in our marketing because we know that Google places a high value on reviews. But they actually look at three things. The number of Google reviews you get every month, the velocity of those reviews, how frequently are new reviews coming in, and number three, the character of your reviews. By character, they mean, are they narrative form? You know, it's one thing if you get a five-star review and the patient doesn't say anything. Well, that's still a five-star review, better than nothing. But it's not full value to Google. Secondly, you can get a Google review that gives you five stars and maybe writes two words, great office. Now, again, that's better than just the five-star review, but not a lot of value in the two words. But what Google really values is narrative, long-form reviews, where the patient wrote four, five, six sentences. Those have higher weighting. So we're going to track your Google reviews. Very important. Number two, call conversions.
So just Gary, real quick, on the Google reviews, what you're saying is all these KPIs, it's a number, right? So in the case of Google reviews, you might say, I want 10 new Google reviews every month. So if that's your KPI, I want 10 new Google reviews, are you hitting it? Are you not hitting
Correct.
It?
Correct. And very, very important point, Aaron. Thank you for raising that because every office might have a different number of Google reviews based on your history and based on your current velocity of those reviews. If you're an office that has historically been getting 12 every month, maybe we want to ramp that up to 15 and maybe we set the KPI at 15.
Right.
Does that make sense?
Absolutely. So this is how you make next year your best year, you know, because if you just keep working on these nine KPIs and every month you are hitting your goals, your targets, you're going to have a good year.
Yeah, it just comes together. You know, it's literally like focusing on every golf shot. If you're playing a round of golf, you know, ultimately your score is those 18 holes, you know, is your score. But it really relates to every single shot. Is every single shot moving me towards my goal, you know, for my round of golf? Number two is call conversions. And again, that's the percentage of inbound calls that come in from new potential patients that convert to a new patient appointment. And just to set a benchmark here, we're looking for 70% or above. So if you got 20 potential new patient calls during the month, we'd like at least 14 of those, that'd be 70%, to result in a new patient appointment. So again, you're going to set your KPI uniquely based on your current performance level. And if you're not tracking, there'll be many listeners that are not tracking this. It's critically important to track this.
Yeah, I know one of the things we do for our mutual clients is every single month they get a report where 150 calls are listened to and they know what their conversion rate is. So if they are at 40% and they need to work towards getting to 70%.
Yeah, the goal is 70% is an A on the report card. And it is possible. How can I say that? You know, we achieve that consistently in my own prep. We're actually at 90% historically in terms of call conversion. So if
can you share your numbers, Gary? How many new patient calls do you get versus how many do you convert?
So we get on average between 100 and 105 potential new patient calls every month, between 100 and 105. And out of those, we historically convert 90% of those to a kept new patient appointment, somewhere between 90 and 95 new patients every month. By the way, Naren, we have you to thank, you and your team at Equa, for the marketing support to make that phone ring and get 100 to 105 potential new patient calls every month.
You're very welcome, Gary.
But if our listeners aren't tracking that, they have no idea what's. They may think they have a marketing problem because they aren't getting the doctor may say, I'm not getting enough new patients. When in fact, they may be getting enough new patient calls, but they're not converting those to calls. That's not a marketing problem. That's a training problem with our admin team on the phones. So very important to track your call conversions. And again, that's going to be set individually based on your history of where you are. Number three, the new patients every month. Critical. It's like taking the pulse of the practice. We like to see in my practice, ideally 90 new patients a month. Now, granted, that is not to impose that number on you. Your number may not need that many new patients, but we have a really good system to handle, 90 new patients a month. I really don't want any more than that. If I had more than that, we might not, the new patient experience might be watered down and not as effective as it could be. Number four, hygiene production. I want hygiene production to be 33% of the total office production, 33% or more. So very important to measure that as a subset with your total office production. Does that make sense, Naren?
Absolutely, Gary. Yes, hygiene has to be 1/3. So that's the next goal. That makes sense.
Well, and if many times we see with new clients that their hygiene production is in the teens percentage-wise. Mm. It's 15, 16, 17%. I'm probably not going to set that KPI if an office is at 16% currently. I'm not going to set it at 33%. Why would you think I wouldn't set it at 33, man?
It's just too hard, right? I mean, they have to double it.
It's not realistic. And there's nothing more defeating for team members than to have a goal that is so far out of the realm that they think it's not possible. So again, your own KPI has to be set uniquely based on your practice history. Total office production. Again, that's the top end number of what's happening in the practice, total office production. And we're going to use history to set that number. Very important. Number six is whitening. I need to take a minute and explain this because many of our listeners are probably thinking, Gary, I thought you said these are the 9 most important KPIs. Whitening isn't even on my radar screen.
Right.
I get it. But I'm going to hopefully change your mind. I'm not interested in whitening revenue, Naren. I mean, it isn't that much. But I'm interested in the way whitening drives other things in your practice. Whitening is a gateway service. The typical office that provides whitening, Naren, does one whitening procedure a month. And at the end of 6 months, Naren, I don't even need your help to do the math on this one, but I'm going to ask you to do the math. At the end of 6 months, how many patients have gotten whiter teeth through my practice?
If you do one a day?
A month.
One a month, six.
That's why I said I didn't even need your help.
Yes.
Now, our goal is to do one a day. And let's say a number of work days this month, we average, because we're open Monday through Friday, we average somewhere around 22 work days a month. Let's use 22.
Right.
At the end of 6 months, we do 22 a month. How many patients have whiter teeth in our practice?
132.
Doctors, which would you rather have, 6 or 132? Take as long as you like. You have 6 people saying, Doc, I love the color of my teeth, but what about this? What about that? What about this? Or would you rather have 132 people saying, Doc, I love the color of my teeth, but what about this? What about that? What about that? It's a driver.
It drives your cosmetic practice, right?
Well, it not just cosmetic, even just basic everyday dentistry. People with old amalgam fillings are saying, hey, I heard there's these white colored fillings. Can we replace these old ones with new ones? So yes, I mean, it drives aesthetic dentistry and cosmetic dentistry, but it can drive everyday general dentistry as well.
Makes sense.
Yeah. Number 7, total office collections. Obviously that's what is a critically important number because it's real. It's dollars that came in. We want to track that. Number eight, your collection percentage. The way we figure your collection percentage is we look at what you collected as a percent of your adjusted monthly production. Adjusted monthly production. And the benchmark I'm looking for ideally is 99% or above. That's a tough one, Naren. I set that deliberately with a high, I raised the bar on that. It's a tough one to achieve. I want 99% or above. 99% or above. And again, that's your collections as a percentage of your adjusted monthly production. Adjusted monthly production. Number nine, total accounts receivable ratio. That's where you take everything that's owed the practice, every dollar that's owed the practice, patient accounts and insurance accounts, and divide that by your average monthly production. Average monthly production. Total accounts receivable divided by your average monthly production. And what I'm looking for is an accounts receivable ratio of 1.0 or less. And what that means mathematically, Naren, is that you're carrying less than 1 month at 1.0. A ratio of 1.0 would mean that you're carrying 1 month of production in your accounts receivable. So if you had an office that produces and collects $100,000 a month, if your accounts receivable are at $100,000 or less, that's an A on the report card for accounts receivable ratio.
Makes sense.
But I want that. So Naren, do the math for me. Let's say we have total accounts receivable of $75,000 and the average monthly production is $100,000. What's my accounts receivable ratio?
Total.
What's my accounts receivable ratio?
It's one.
It's 0.75.
0.7. Wait a minute. So it's.
75,000 divided by 100,000.
100,000. Okay, got it.
It's
yeah,
0.75. What if it was 50,000 on that same $100,000 practice? What's my
ratio? It's 0.5. Right.
And ideally, I'd like that to be low as possible, but anything at 1.0 or less is good.
Right. Makes sense.
So now that you've got it, I'll recap them really quick. Number one, Google reviews. Number two, call conversions. Number three, new patients. Number four, hygiene production. Number five, total office production. Number six, whitening procedures. Number seven, total office collection. Number eight, collection percentage. Number nine, total accounts receivable ratio. Now, let's leap forward and tie each one of these to a system or systems in our 24 systems that will allow you to get that result. Allow you to get that result. This is where
and one of the things
meets the road.
We can do is we can put a link to that two Thriving Dentist podcast you did, Gary, where you literally go through these 24 systems. So if anyone wants to kind of go back and refresh their memory on what these systems are, they can go ahead and do that.
Yeah, we'll put it's part one and part two because we divided them into first one was systems 1 through 12, and the second one was systems 13 through 24. All right, so KPI number one, Google reviews. There's two systems that will support that. System number 10, a system to collect more Google reviews, and system 17, system for an effective morning huddle. Now, why do you think I put the morning huddle system in there as a way to drive this KPI, Naren?
The reason you put the morning huddle is because, Gary, I know because I've seen you do this with mutual clients, is you really make sure that they identify the exact people that you're going to ask for reviews from that morning. And
ding,
that happens
ding,
in the morning
ding,
huddle.
Ding. So now people are paying attention because we're going to talk about who on our schedule are we going to ask. Who's on our schedule today that we're going to ask to write a Google review? So there's two very specific of those 24 systems that'll support this. So Naren, if your goal is 15 more Google reviews in a month, and you're currently getting 7 or 8, we need to go back and strengthen system 10 and system 17, because that will get you to 15.
Exactly.
So it's kind of like, you know, if I'm playing golf, and my score is above my goal, and I discover what I need to work on is putting, I need to spend some time on the practice putting green, you know, improving my putting.
Right.
Makes sense?
And there's a third system that I think that also helps in this case is the bonus system, right?
Well, yes. If we choose to bonus reviews, then the bonus system can also be a system that drives any of these KPIs as well. Yeah. Let's go to the next KPI, KPI number two, call conversions. And what I'm going to do here, rather than point back to systems, I'm going to point to two Thriving Dentist Show episodes that cover this in detail. So if our call conversions are under 70%, then go to Thriving Dentist Show episode number 443. It's called Four Tips to Convert Potential New Patient Calls to Appointments. So let's put that in the notes, Naren.
Yes.
And then the second one is Thriving Dentist Show episode 494, which is titled What We Have Learned in Call Recording and Call Coaching. All the answers are there. All the answers are there. So that will help you increase your call conversions. All right, let's go to KPI number three, new patient flow. New patient flow. There's actually three systems that will support that one. First one is system number two. It's a scheduling template to schedule new patients within 3 days. Now, Naren, this is right in your wheelhouse. Why is that one so important?
It's really important because I know, like, you know, in your case, you get around, 100 plus new patient calls. And imagine you tell them, oh, it's going to be 2 months before you see the doctor. People are like, you know what? I'll call back.
Never
and
mind.
Usually call back means they're never calling back.
Never mind. So you want to have a system. Now, I will flex that a little bit. Ideally, it's less than, 3 days or less. But we could stretch that a little bit and say a week or less. Today, if you're having high demand, we schedule a new patient within a week or less.
Yeah, I'm a huge fan of this because I know you could have the phone ring all day long, but if this is not there, in other words, if patients can't see you within a reasonable time frame, either they are not booking or they are booking and not showing up because they found somebody else.
And the doctor might think, again, my marketing's not working because I don't have the number of new patients I want. And the doctor may not know that the first available new patient slot's 6 weeks out. The marketing's working just fine. But the way we're handling it isn't working as well internally. The second system to support this is system number nine, a system to ask for patient referrals. Well, that's self-evident. The more referrals we get, the more new patients you're going to get. So we go back and revisit system number nine. And system 21, a system for a remarkable new patient experience. The reason why that system supports this is the stronger we make the new patient experience, the more people are out there talking about us and talking to their friends, their coworkers, their family, but they're also talking about us online. Google reviews, Yelp reviews, Facebook reviews. So the stronger your new patient experience is, the more likely people are going to be talking about us, drawing attention to your practice, like a magnet attracting more new patients.
I was going to say, Gary, that is a element also, right? You have the 10 elements, which is the marketing, effective marketing program to drive new patients. Can you comment on that?
Yeah, Thriving Dentist MBA workshop, I go through the 10 elements of a thriving practice. And the second element is mastering digital marketing. And it's really through mastering digital marketing that allows your practice to get the right number of new patient flow. And it's just a great way to ensure that you have a continually growing, thriving practice. And mastering marketing today means mastering Google and showing up on page one when a potential patient in your community is looking for a dentist in your community. And of course, you're an important piece of that for us because it's your agency, Equa, that supports us in all of that. KPI number four, hygiene production. Remember, we want that to be 33% or more in your practice. There's actually four specific systems that support that. System number three, hygiene scheduling template to produce $1,200 per day per hygienist. System 15, a system to reactivate past due hygiene patients. Every practice has patients that are slipping away, and we got to reactivate them before they disappear. It's much easier to keep an existing patient than go out and find a new one. System number 20, it's a conservative periodontal therapy system. Many offices are underperforming in their treatment of conservative periodontal therapy conservative periodontal therapy protocols in your hygiene department. And if your hygiene department's underproducing, it's likely that you're not diagnosing and treating perio to your potential. Great system for that, system number 20. And system number 24 is a hygiene confirmation system that actually includes a process for confirming at-risk hygiene patients. So in our hygiene confirmation system, we have two systems, a default system for our reliable patients that are shown reliability. And then secondly, we have a second system for those that are at risk. And when I say at risk, I don't mean medically at risk. I mean at risk of not showing up. And that's system number 24.
Makes sense. Let's
go to KPI number 4, total office production. That's KPI number 5. I miscounted. There's 4 different systems that help us drive our production. System 1 is a scheduling template to achieve a daily production goal. Your team can't help you get your goal if they don't know what the goal is. System 7, it's a system to follow up on unscheduled treatment plans for general dentistry. If it doesn't hurt, many people are not inclined to move forward with treatment, and we need a system to follow up on those patients so they don't just disappear. System 8, a system to follow up on treatment plans for high-value dentistry. In the same way that everyday general dentistry patients might be unscheduled, we want to make sure that any of our unscheduled treatment plans for high-value dentistry that we're following back up on. And system number 13 is the system for conversion exams. That's where we are converting existing patients to almost being like a new patient in our practice by updating our records, taking a full set of digital photos for patient education. Perhaps when that patient first came into our practice, we didn't have a CBCT, and now we have a CBCT. So that'd be the idea. If the patient could benefit from a cone beam, then we'll take a 3D image through the cone beam. So those are the 4 systems that help us drive our production. The next system is whitening. KPI number 6, if I'm counting right, is whitening. And we have a specific system for that. It's system number 12. It's a system to achieve a whitening goal of 1 whitening procedure per day. 1 whitening procedure a day. KPI number 7, if I go back to 7, is total office collections. We have a great system to support that. It's system number 14, a system to provide a full range of payment options to accommodate virtually any patient. We've got to have options. If the patient says, "Doc, I'd love to have this done, but I can't afford it," we want to make sure we have options that work for the patient and work for us. And system number 14 is the one that provides that. KPI number 8, our collection percentage. We have system number 4 for that. It's a payment system to collect the patient copayment at or before time of service. System to collect patient copayment at or before time of service. If we're successful with that, then that KPI is going to be in the range. Remember, we want 99% or above. KPI number 9, total accounts receivable ratio. We have 2 systems to support that. System number 5, it's a system to follow up on past due insurance claims. So those are claims that are outstanding that we can follow up on. Remember, the squeaky wheel gets the grease on that. Why do insurance companies take as long as they take to pay sometimes? Because we let them.
Yeah.
So we got to stop letting them. We got to follow up on that. And system 6 supports this KPI, and that's a system to follow up on past due patient accounts. In the same way, Naren, if we don't follow up with any outstanding patient accounts, we're training our patients not to pay you. Dr. Phil has a famous saying that I'll quote here. You know, Dr. Phil, the television psychologist personality. Dr. Phil says, "We train people how to treat us." And I believe that's true. If someone has made a payment arrangement, Naren, and we don't follow up on it, you're just basically telling the patient, "Oh, we weren't very serious about this. You know, you can do whatever you want." That's what you're telling them by your act, not by your words, but by your action. Well, there are those 9 KPIs tied to specific systems or resources. You know, in the case of helping your conversion percentage, we're tying you back to resources. So there's the KPI tied back to a specific system or systems or resources that will help you get there. So this is often I can't tell you, Naren, we've started to do this with our clients. We track these 9 KPIs. And we did some very specific training with each one of our clients on the relationship between these systems to the KPIs. And I can't tell you how many of our clients have literally said, "Gary, the light bulb has finally gone off for me. I now understand the relationship between the systems and my practice performance." And furthermore, I have an easy dashboard to take a look at. We provide that dashboard for our clients. I have an easy dashboard to look at where does my practice need attention. And now it's all done by data and analytics, Naren, instead of seat of the pants guesswork. You know, I've in the past, clients have told me, Gary, I know my practice needs work, but I don't know where that, I don't know where to focus my work on. I don't know where to focus my energy on. Doctors, if you as a listener have ever experienced that, no, you've got massive company among your colleagues. But now you can look at the data. Data never lies. You can look at the data and you can look at your dashboard. Our dashboard is color-coded, red, yellow, green. Green means we're on goal. Everything's humming. Yellow means close, not quite. We could use some improvement. And red means, you know, warning, warning. We got to pay attention here. It's like a instrument panel for a pilot. If you look at the instrument panel and something is flashing red, the pilot is going to pay attention to it. Could be catastrophic if they don't.
Right.
So that's what this does. So 9 KPIs tied to very specific systems. And now if something isn't performing up to your standard, you go back to the systems. Now, Naren, let's really take a leap and tie this into a culture of accountability. A culture of accountability. Many dentists have told me over the years that they're interested in creating more accountability in their practice. And when I ask them to tell me more about that, the typical story that I hear is, I've got no accountability in my practice. And I want to help my team members become more accountable. And that is commonplace.
Yeah, but in other words, a lot of dentists feel like they are pulling all the weight on their own shoulders, as opposed to, you know, we have 10 people in our team and all 10 people together are pulling the weight, you know. Right.
Yeah. And it relieves the burden. It really helps our team members focus their time and energy, and it produces great results. So now imagine tying a KPI and systems to a particular team member. Mm. Like for example, let's go back to the first one, KPI number one, a system to grow your Google reviews.
Right.
And let's say we have a Google review champion in the practice. I like to use the word champion.
Right.
No one wants another job, but everyone wants to be a champion.
Yes.
And let's say that person's name is Maria.
Right.
And Maria is just great at it. She loves everything related to reviews. She likes social media. She's outgoing, gregarious, likes to talk to people. And so she's our systems champion. And we let Maria know that, you know, Maria, every year we do an evaluation with our team members on how they're doing. And we do that for your benefit and our benefit. And Maria, you have many job responsibilities here. But the number one way we're going to measure your success is your success with that Google review KPI. Now we'll look at everything, but the number one criteria we'll look at your success is the Google review. If you do everything else well, but you fail at that one, Maria, then that's not going to be a good review.
Right.
But I have 100% confidence you're going to do really well at this. So now we show her the resources, the system. We give her the metrics, the measurement to know how she, it's not just more reviews, but it's tied to something very specific. So let's say that goal was 15 a month. And at the end of the year, so 15 a month would be 180 at the end of the year, 15 times 12 would be 180. And what if Maria shows up to that review with the scorecard that says the office did 200 new Google reviews last year? How's that review going to go with Maria?
It's going to be amazing.
It's going to be a happy party. Yeah. It's going to be a happy party. You know, Maria, way to go. You knocked it out of the park. Fantastic. So that helps us create accountability because now I think oftentimes, Naren, now my belief system, and this is based on experience, is that most practices have really great people.
Mm-hmm.
Most do. No, right. There's certainly exceptions to that. But most, and I think among our listeners, most of our listeners have team members that are great team members, or they wouldn't be there.
Right.
But they don't have any direction on how they can impact the practice. They haven't gotten any direction.
Yeah, I think what you're saying is, again, let me summarize the thesis of today's episode, which is there are 9 key metrics, KPIs, in your experience, you find if these metrics continue to improve or KPIs continue to improve, the practice will do better every year, every quarter, because just these are the things that drive the practice. Second key point you're making here is, if the doctor or a single person in the practice is in charge of all 9 KPIs, it's just going to be overwhelming. So you need to divide and conquer. So you need to, in one way, give people responsibility, because we all like to step up. We all like to be champions. But at the same time, it's much more fun when it's a team effort, as opposed to what you call accountability driven practice, as opposed to single person driven practice, which is what, unfortunately, many struggling practices are.
Right. Very much. You just nailed it. Very much so. And now a team member can thrive in the prep because they know what that means. They know what that means to do. I mean, many times I've heard from team members that say, I just don't know how to please the doctor.
Yeah, it's like let's say you are a front desk person or a dental assistant. You're doing so many things, but you don't feel like you made a difference. Here, that particular individual makes a difference. And because she got 200 reviews.
And by the way, everything here is objective.
Right. It's black and white. Subjective. It's measured.
Yes. It's subjective would be, I think I did a good job.
Right.
Well, this is nothing about this is subjective. It's all objective. I've given you a measurement, a hard number measurement that you can use every time.
Right.
And now we can measure performance. Bill Bowerman, the noted track coach of University of Oregon. I'm an Oregon graduate. Great respect for Bill Bowerman. Bill Bowerman said very famously, things that are measured improve. Things that are measured improve. And then he added a corollary to that. When the improvement is reported back, the improvement can become astounding. So things that are measured improve.
Okay.
And then when you report it back, the improvement can be astounding.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what we're doing here, is we're providing immediate feedback, real-time feedback. You have to provide your team members the resources.
Right.
To do that, the resources. So for example, if whitening is a stumbling point in your practice, one of the things I discover when whitening is non-existent in the practice, oftentimes the practice has some old whitening system that nobody believes in anymore. So they're not going to promote this to the patients if they don't believe in it. So providing the resources means doctor would sit down with the team members and say, hey, let's throw the baby out with the bathwater here. And let's come up with a whitening system. By that, I'm talking about the actual process of whitening that we all believe in. And if we all believe in it, then we can promote it. So the doctor's role is to provide the resources.
So what you and your team do, Gary, and that's the magic of this, is that a lot of people who go into dentistry, none of them, at least I can't think of a single one, who said, I want to be a business genius. I want to, manage a team of 10 people. That's my dream. They go there to help people. They go there to cure people, right? That's why they got into, dentistry.
They're caregivers.
They're caregivers. So what you and your team do is, number one, you measure the metrics, these 9 KPIs, every single month. So you know where you were last month. You know, is it going in the right direction? Are we lagging behind? So because if you don't know it, you can't do anything about it. And then your team and you just look at, where are we doing really well? Kudos, keep doing it. When we're not doing really well, why are we stuck? Where is the problem? How do we troubleshoot? And I think that combination is almost like what Paul and Tim have, right? In your Life Smiles practice, where you take care of the business side while they focus on dentistry. I think that's the reason why, almost all your clients have the best year every year.
I've enjoyed this episode, Naren, because it really gave you kind of a peek behind the curtain of what we do every day in our work. It's proven. I mean, we see practice after practice after practice that are using this information to follow my favorite axiom, which is simply to be better tomorrow than we are today. My goal in life is to be better tomorrow than I am today. And this is something that we can convert to your practice. And it's a really cool dynamic, and it creates a vital, thriving, dynamic practice that really, and is all of it's patient-centered. It's how can we best take care of our patients. These metrics and numbers are simply to measure how well we're doing at that. They aren't the reason we're doing what we're doing. The reason has to be to change people's lives. But these are the scorecard, or the way we can measure how we're doing at changing people's lives.
Gary, is it okay if we include a link to your coaching program, which is thrivingdentist.com? Because you know what? Because I have some people in my office today, some dentists, and they were listening. And I think while you were speaking, one of the things they said was, this is tough. I mean, they understand it intellectually, but it's one thing to understand it, but then it's another thing to do it day in and day out, week in and week out, month in and month out. So they were inquiring about your coaching. So I was just wondering if that's something that Please. We can share.
Yeah, thrivingdentist.com/coaching. By the way, we are accepting new clients. At the time of recording this, we are accepting new clients. We do limit the number of clients we work with because of the intensity of the support. And I'd never have more clients than we can support with myself and my team. But as of right now, as the time of this recording, we are accepting new clients. Go to thrivingdentist.com/coaching. Learn more about our coaching services. I think you'll find they're very cost-effective, very affordable, and produce amazing results. Hey, as we bring a ribbon on this, put a ribbon on this one today, circle back. I want to talk about coming up on June 21st, 22nd, 23rd. We have our Thriving Dentist MBA workshop. Come join us. If you like for that, you can go to thrivingdentist.com/MBA. Also want to thank you, Naren, and your team at Equa for all the support you provide me in terms of marketing. And also, I often recommend you to my clients that could use improved marketing. But I'd also recommend you to any of our listeners. I also want to take a minute and thank our listeners. We sure appreciate each and every one of you here at the Thriving Dentist Show. I do have a favor to ask. If you haven't done it already, jump on iTunes and write us a review. If you go to the Thriving Dentist Show, you can scroll down. You'll see a place to write a review. Writing a review for us on iTunes helps more dentists find us in the same way that a positive Google review works for your practice. On that note, let me simply say thank you and tell you I will look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show. Dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide. And don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride. Don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. And when you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.